They're supposed to give me a signal that they're ready. Hello, welcome everyone. My name is Chris Gilliard, and I'll be the moderator today. I'm actually thrilled to be here. I hope everyone else is as well. Just a brief introduction of the speakers. First, we have Solon Barocas and Karen Levy. I apologize. I should have asked that beforehand. And their talk is Refractive Surveillance, New Data Ecologies in the Workplace. Karina Russ, her talk is on being warrant-proof. Matthew Crane, The Transparency Trap, Data Brokers and the Limits of Consumer Empowerment. And Joan Donovan on the Ferguson Effect.
I'm going to stand up, is it okay if I just leave the mic, you think? Small enough?
No. They know I think you
can use the mic.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
You could put it
up higher.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, man, seriously. Hi, everyone. thanks for the introduction, Chris. So Karen and I will be presenting some work in progress, which relates to a project trying to think a little bit differently about surveillance. And we kind of start by considering the kind of standard model of surveillance, which we see as a dyadic relationship, one where there's sort of a person observing, and then there's the observed. And that the kind of interests and issues at stake in that relationship tend to be ones where we care about what the effects are on this particular person being observed, what power the observer can exercise over the observed. Things like what degree of control they might have over them. And in particular, it's this particular individual that's being directly observed whose interests we tend to think about in this traditional model. And so when we ask, what does privacy do in the context of surveillance, it tends to be something that is sort of protecting this specific person who is being subject to observation. And there's been some this standard way of thinking about the problem has been criticized in a number of ways, recently especially. And one to which I'm very sympathetic to has to do with the idea that privacy, trying to think about the effects of data collection and observation, not really capturing the issues that really arise from discrimination. So how the information you collect actually affects people's life chances, the decisions they're subject to, and so on, and that perhaps privacy is inadequate to get to those issues. There's also, I think, an important move away from a focus on privacy as being something that, you know, is really about individual control to asking questions about how surveillance actually is also itself a social justice issue, not just about making sure that people are in control of what information is collected and how it's used. And the kind of complement to this seems to me to be the kind of more philosophical argument that comes out of work like Julie Cohen's, which basically is criticizing the idea that privacy is really an individual interest and right, and that, in fact, what's being imagined in most of the conversations about privacy is this kind of idealized liberal subject, when in fact, really the kind of subjectivities we care about are highly interdependent, that these are not values that can be disentangled from the way we interact with each other. And that the preoccupation with autonomy and some of the traditional thinking about surveillance should kind of give way to more concern around sociality and the way that we interact with each other and can kind of interact effectively. Okay, I'll hand it off to you.
So based on those critiques, what Solon and I are working on is developing a theory of surveillance and privacy that we think more adequately takes account of both the types of harms that sometimes don't get recognized when we think of surveillance as a two-party relationship, and then the interdependent nature of modern life, such that we don't all live as individuals and surveillance relationships are not just two-party relationships. So we've been calling this idea refractive surveillance. And the idea here that is super essential to this model is that data that's collected about you may have really intense and serious implications for someone else, right? So that the effects of surveillance, it's not a dyadic relationship, but that it's a relationship that actually has a much broader reach than that. And that calls on us as researchers to study information flows in a much more ecological way, where we understand how information is flowing through networks of people and networks of entities. And one of the things that we think really advantages this model is that we think it enables privacy to speak more directly to issues of economic justice in a way that's pretty hard to capture if you just think about privacy in a two-party relationship. So this is kind of a graphic illustration of what we're talking about, right? So this old model is this two-party information flows up and control flows down to the person about whom information is collected. Under this refractive surveillance idea, sometimes information collected about person A is used to control person B, right? So information and control get decoupled in a way that we think is really important and actually pretty empirically widespread in modern life. So we've been investigating this specifically at one particular field site, which is the low-wage retail labor context, so like stores and restaurants. And we picked the site for a bunch of reasons, most specifically because for poor people, the workplace, like the low-wage workplace, especially retail, is a very distinct site, obviously, of economic redistribution, hugely important, and that there's actually been a fair amount of attention recently to paying attention to surveillance in the workplace, but in a different way, right, in thinking about how surveillance is enacted over employees, and to some extent, how surveillance is enacted over customers, but with not much crossover between those two things, right, not much recognition of how the interests and observation of customers and workers might be related. So that's what we're asking, is how it is that surveillance of customers by these retail companies implicates the economic interests of workers. Okay, so Solon will
And so one of the ways that we're doing that is by studying some new retail technology, of which there's a huge amount, and we'll give you two examples. So one is Retail Next, which is a company that does something that a number of companies now do, which is basically try to figure out how to bring the customer tracking that is pervasive online to the offline brick and mortar space. So how do we actually follow consumers as they are kind of shopping and navigating these retail spaces? And there's a number of ways that they do this, including things like the fact that your cell phone is constantly checking to see what Wi-Fi is in the local area actually communicates to the Wi-Fi hub that you are physically there. And this is a way to actually track individuals both over time, but also in space based on the strength of the signal. And that there's certain ways too to sort of kind of more aggressive ways to potentially matching information you might have about customers from their online transactions to them in physical space when they check out at the counter, and you know that the person standing there is this phone, and then you pay with your credit card and you now know that this phone is actually this particular person's phone. And so these things have attracted a lot of attention from consumer privacy researchers and advocates. But what we're trying to argue here is that a lot of this information is actually being redirected toward very specific management practices of employees, of workers. And that's what we're trying to highlight here. And so to give another example of that, IoLabs is a company that basically is trying to help stores send workers to the customer and to kind of scaffold their interaction with those customers by telling them, thanks, Chris, by telling them, this is this particular person, they seem to be interested in these products, and so on and so forth, in a way that you might have in the online world. And again, here, the idea is that there's an enormous amount of information that's being collected about consumers that might have been perceived as worrisome, but it actually is seriously transforming the nature of worker management. Yes, and then I'll switch over.
So, In our research, we've been tracing some of the mechanisms through which this observation of consumers, data collection about consumers in a bunch of different ways, is implicating the economic interests of workers through these kind of different management practices and different corporate practices. So we're not going to talk through this whole gamut of things that we've been looking at, but we've basically identified four major mechanisms, by which this data collection is implicating workers' economic rights and interests, right? And so what's important about the four of these is that each one of them entails the shifting, the displacement of economic risk from a company onto a worker. And I'm going to talk about, or we'll talk about two of them specifically to try and illustrate how that happens. So the first one is schedule instability. So this is drawing on, so what happens is that retailers use a bunch of customer tracking data, especially traffic data, like the kind of stuff that Solon was talking about, knowing who's in the store at what time, what part of the store they're in, what time they come in, how long they're there, that kind of thing. They gather lots and lots of data about what consumers are doing. And the goal that they have is to schedule labor in such a way that you meet demand but don't exceed capacity, right? It's not to your advantage as a retailer to have a bunch of extra staff, obviously, because that's a huge cost to you, but it is advantageous to have the right number of staff for the right number of customers. And the old way that that retailers would do this is just with sales data, but that's pretty imperfect, right? Because that only tells you who actually bought a thing. It doesn't tell you who entered the store but left because the lines were too long. It doesn't tell you about potential sales you might have had if you'd only deployed the right person to the right place. So a big trend is to use these traffic data that are much more personally invasive potentially to inform algorithms that allow you to do better worker scheduling, both in terms of the number of hours people are there and when those hours are, and then also within the store, like where they're deployed within the store. The issue is that, like, and this has gotten some public attention, so you guys may be familiar with this, the scheduling algorithms facilitate much more granular forecasting, right, which enables you to map your labor in a much more granular, fine-grained way. The issue that this affects for workers is that it creates enormous instability. So it means that workers work maybe shorter shifts, they work split shifts, right? So they come in only for like particularly high traffic moments, which may be much shorter than like the old, you know, under an old system where you'd work 4 hours, maybe now you work an hour, and then when traffic picks up again, you work another hour, but the 2 hours in between, you're kind of like stranded, right? So it makes it, there's a lot of research that demonstrates that this dynamic makes it much harder for workers to hold another job, to have reliable childcare. Another big issue this facilitates is because the forecasts are much more dynamic in time, like there's a much greater use of what are called call-in shifts, or sometimes actually physical shifts where a worker has to either call in like shortly before a shift is scheduled, or sometimes actually even physically show up to a store but not clock in until like the algorithm says it's okay, until like the labor and sales ratio is what the company wants it to be. So obviously that's incredibly disruptive for workers and you know eats up a lot of their time in ways that are super detrimental and actually cause intergenerational harm. So there have been studies pointing to like cognitive effects on workers' children when their schedules are unstable in this way.
And so the other thing that we're interested in too is how some of the kind of scaffolding of interactions between workers and customers can potentially make workers more substitutable. So there might be a fair amount of training involved in explaining to people who work in these places what the product is, what's desirable about the product, kind of detailed technical knowledge about the things that they're actually selling. At the same time, they might also develop lots of relationships with customers over time, and one of their values as a worker could be that they actually are quite knowledgeable about what they're selling and have existing relationships with customers. And a lot of the technology that's been introduced to kind of streamline that process actually involves externalizing a fair amount of that knowledge. So you have customer preferences that you don't elicit through interactions on the floor, but instead draw from databases that you've compiled elsewhere. Or you actually have the particular retail staff write notes to explain that this is the particular thing that this person seems to be interested in. And in effect, all the kind of embodied knowledge that made workers actually valuable and difficult to replace are now being externalized in a way that makes them very substitutable. In the last minute, should I just do this? I forget which slide. Okay. So the kind of takeaway that we're trying to offer here is that there's this kind of maybe somewhat surprising solidarity where customers attempt to preserve their own privacy can actually have the effect of preserving a certain degree of uncertainty that makes it difficult for companies to actually make workers' lives much more unstable or make them easier to dispose of, and that this refractive model that we're proposing of surveillance actually can point to these new possibilities, coalitions, which really bring together parties which have historically just been perceived as totally unrelated. And that there's actually a way of thinking of privacy still as a potential important lever for pursuing economic justice. So, thanks very much.
Hello, everybody. Is this okay? Okay. Okay. My name is Karina. I am a graduate student in the Department of Sociology at University of Washington. And I have to apologize in advance. I got in at 1 o'clock in the morning from Seattle, and I've had nothing but burnt coffee today. So apologies if my synapses are not firing on time. And I am going to be reading from some notes just because I know if I don't, there's no way in hell I'll be done before 12 minutes. So bear with me a little bit. Okay, so the topic I'm going to be discussing today is encryption and how it's related to privacy, surveillance, and police power. But before I start, I just want to give some brief background information that I think will be helpful in interpreting some of my findings. And first is that encryption, if you don't know, is essentially just a method of scrambling data so that only the people who are a part of the conversations can understand what is being said. In order to decrypt the information, you would need a key. So only the people in possession of the key can understand or decrypt the data. And when I say a backdoor, because I'm going to use a backdoor sort of as an umbrella term to save time, what I mean there is either that the keys are being held by some third party or that there's some vulnerability in the system that is built so that it can be exploited. So that's what I mean by backdoor. And there's been three sort of broad phases in government attempts to encourage backdoor systems and encryption systems. And this project started from 1990. Of course, this extends back far before that. But for the scope of this, I've started in 1990. And since then, there's been three sort of broad stages in how the government has tried to build backdoors into encryption systems. The first, if you'll remember, is the Clipper chip, or if you were like me, you were 4 years old when that was proposed. But that was the first sort of stage in the early 90s to try and build this escrow system where keys would be stockpiled with a third party, and those keys would later be sort of queried by law enforcement whenever they need them. And the second one, where when the Clipper chip was withdrawn by the Clinton administration, what they tried to do then is salvage some of what they had built and encourage this key recovery system, which is sort of a watered-down version of escrow, where the keys are accessible, not necessarily stockpiled. And then the last one, which is what we are sort of in the midst of right now, is this age of what I call these individualized solutions, this dialogue with industry, appeals to corporate responsibility, and very recently we've seen some resort to the court system as well. So that's just some background information. Okay. And many people, including myself, tend to refer to the defeat of the Clipper chip as just that. It's a defeat. It was a win for privacy. It's a great example of what can happen when privacy advocates sort of organize and mobilize against certain surveillance proposals, and we can really, you know, check the encroachment of surveillance into our daily lives when we organize around privacy. But the question that I want to pose is, was it really an unqualified victory, or is there something else going on here? Mostly, I'm concerned in any case where there's a coalition of interest between business and privacy advocates around surveillance. So I wanted to see what is going on in this situation. Can we unpack what's happening? And so more specifically, I'm asking about the relationship between privacy, surveillance, and encryption. It seems like it would be a pretty straightforward and obvious relationship, but I want to get in there and see if there's actually anything else a little bit more complicated going on. Okay, in terms of the theoretical framework I'm working in, I'm going to skip over most of this, obviously, in the interest of time, but I do want to point out one thing that I'm interested in, is that is the idea that there is a way in which privacy discourses or critiques of surveillance based on privacy can actually inadvertently legitimize surveillance practices. And so there's one particular theory by Sammy Cole that's asking, is there a sense where privacy actually is the ally of surveillance? And I think that's a really interesting idea because it's a little bit counterintuitive. So I want to investigate that a little bit. Okay, and in order to answer these questions, what I did is I collected every single congressional hearing about encryption since 1990, as well as every mention of encryption on the congressional record since 1990. There's actually a big gap in between 2000 and about 2011, so most of it is clustered sort of in the 90s and then from 2011 onward. And I conducted a content analysis, and I can answer questions about the methods if you have questions, but I won't bore you with them now. Okay, and this study actually had two findings, but I only will have time to talk about the second one today. But I do want to point out the first one because maybe I'm biased, but I think it's also really interesting. And that's this idea that actually a lot of the critiques that of these encryption backdoor proposals were not based on these constitutional and sort of rights-based discourses of privacy. They were actually about markets, which is really interesting. And a lot of them actually tended to reinforce logics of informational capitalism. A lot of times when privacy was brought up, it was not because people have a right to some autonomy. It was a lot of times it's because privacy is essential for e-commerce, and we need it. We need privacy to engage in, you know, world IT domination by United States companies. Another really interesting argument that came out of this was that U.S. companies, it's actually in the interest of the United States national security interests to deregulate the encryption industry so that companies like Apple can dominate it, and then they can work with the U.S. government to help them with backdoors. A lot of times that's the center of the discussion in the 90s. It was not it was more of that and less about constitutional ideas about privacy. But in terms, this is my favorite picture of former Director Freeze looking very stoic. But what I'm going to talk about for the last 5 minutes or so is actually what I call the shift in socio-technical relationships. And what I mean by that, is that there's the discursive production of the relationship between law enforcement, data, court orders, and encryption has actually shifted over time. So the question that I pose here is actually what kinds of problems is encryption said to present? What does it do? And in the first phase during the 90s, there was a wide variety of responses to this question. Police cannot monitor, they can't wiretap, they can't engage in gathering of evidence, they can't intercept messages, surveillance isn't useful anymore, we can't fight crime, we can't protect the public safety. And although you'll see that there's a lot of variation in the different responses that people had when they were defining what problems encryption poses, the common theme here is that encryption gets in the way of a process, some kind of process of searching, of gathering evidence, right? It was a process of looking for something. And this is what I call the right to search orientation. And that predominantly is how the earlier debates were defined, that encryption gets in the way of searching for data. And these are a couple pointed out quotes just to give you an illustration of what is talked about. Apologies for the text-heavy slide. It's imperative that surveillance is maintained as a viable and effective tool. Encryption prevents court-authorized surveillance efforts, prevents officers from conducting legal searches and seizures. If we don't have it, we'll lose a very important law enforcement tool and the ability to search, and then fewer crimes will be prevented, and criminals will not be caught, prosecuted, or taken off the streets. In contrast, the second, and these are my favorite pictures of our DOJ officials and FBI officials looking very frustrated. and what's going on here is actually a complete shift in the way that encryption is talked about and what the problem with encryption is. Now, instead of saying that it impedes the process of surveillance, now the problem is that they can't get the information that they are authorized to collect. They have a right to collect specific data points, and they can't get that specific data point. So often what this comes out is that they can't obtain the information they're authorized to collect. They're not authorized to search for it. They're authorized to that data. And a lot of times they say that court orders are not being complied with anymore. Encryption prevents companies from complying with court orders. And a lot of times when that phrase gets used, it's used in cases where companies are not providing the specific data that law enforcement wants. So if they know that there's a possibility that some data about some certain event was produced, if they don't get that data, then that court order is not complied with. So now this is what I call the right to information orientation. No longer is it about searching for data, now it's about actually getting the data. And encryption repeals their lawful authority to data points. It's slightly different than saying that they have a right to search. And you can see, contrasting with the quotes from earlier, law enforcement does not provide the government, the industry standard does not provide the government with all the information it's lawfully authorized to collect. It's about law enforcement's inability to collect information the judge has authorized. We can't obtain the information responsive to a court order. We don't have the capability to get the data. And then lastly, things become warrant proof even though the justification for the evidence has been established. So no longer is it about a process of searching now, it's about actually getting data in a legible form that is useful for law enforcement that they can actually read. So the reason why this is important is because it actually, in the going dark debate, especially that's going on right now, deleted data actually gets lumped in with this as well. So they'll say that if data is not retained for long enough, it's essentially causing the same problems that encryption is causing. And that has huge implications for how we understand how carceral logics penetrate into our communications infrastructure. If something is not built according to these carceral logics and in service to the carceral state, it becomes a warrant-proof piece of data, which I think is a very interesting concept. And partially this is why I think a lot of the spatial metaphors used to describe encryption are not really appropriate anymore, because there's sort of a different logic that's governing data collection in digital spaces that does not apply for a lot of physical searches. In physical spaces, we would see more of the right to search orientation, but in digital spaces, we see a lot of talk about right to information. And I think that this, in a sense, well, last thing here, I think I put it up there. I don't know. Warren proof data is actually information that cannot be, that it has not yet been transformed into evidence. So any potential information out there, if it is warrant proof, that means that it hasn't been transformed into evidence yet. And it gets transformed into evidence when it's built according to carceral logics, where data becomes evidence of future crimes. And I think this normalization has huge implications for how we understand the building of mass incarceration, of the carceral state. And in the future, what I hope to do is do some contrast of the United States case with other countries that are obviously focused on the encryption issue as well. And I think I had so much burnt coffee, I finished early, which is great. Okay, awesome. Thank you so much.
How's everyone doing? I really regret not putting like a cat meme or something. This is getting like really heavy, really fast. So this talks about transparency, and a lot of really brilliant and accomplished people have written about this over the years, and that's kind of a blessing and a curse. So what I'm gonna try to do is question the value of transparency. I'm not the first to do that. But I want to argue that in our contemporary landscape of commercial surveillance, we have to understand transparency a little bit differently than we do as a public policy and also as a social good. So I'm going to assume this is a hip crowd in the know that we understand about the commercial surveillance landscape right now, and we can understand that there's a lot of tracking and commercial monitoring going on the internet, so I'll skip the nuts and bolts of that, and we'll start with Louis Brandeis, right? So he has the famous quote about transparency, which is that sunlight is the best disinfectant. And he was talking about banks needing to release information about securities so that investors would have the information they needed to engage in their investing practices. And fast forward 100 years, this is the Federal Trade Commission, and transparency and sunlight is the basic mode of their regulatory approach to the internet and all things regarding commercial monitoring on the internet. So transparency's promise is really about empowerment via information. Brandeis wanted to empower investors by shedding light on the banking transactions, and the FTC wants to empower consumers by giving them information they need to make informed consumer decisions about the practices that they engage in and the companies that they engage with. And so it's about leveling the playing field in a market setting. That's how transparency is generally applied. So in the United States, there's no overarching transparency or privacy legislation that covers everything. It's all ad hoc and piecemeal. And so a set of sort of informal practices coalesced in the 80s called the Fair Information Practices. And this has kind of been the baseline for how regulatory regimes approach the internet and surveillance and commercial monitoring, et cetera. And the two main ones are notice and choice. So you give people notice of what kind of information collection is going on that empowers them then to make a choice about what's happening. And the assumption here is that the consumer is seen, of course, as a perfectly rational actor. So the essential dynamic, again, is about giving consumers adequate control and choice over how their data is used by commercial entities. And this goes back a long way, all the way to the early Clinton administration, when their number one priority when rolling out the internet was to build consumer trust in creating a marketplace. People were scared to put their credit cards online, if you can imagine a time period, right? So let's fast forward a little bit. And there's been a lot of heat lately on commercial data gathering, thanks in large part to Edward Snowden, but even a little bit before that. A lot of agitation by the press and activists have caused industry and regulators to respond in renewed calls for transparency. So one of these renewed strategies is Axiom, is one of the biggest data brokers in the United States. They have a profile about all of you. It's guaranteed, right? And so what they did is they developed this portal, a consumer-facing portal that let you log in, credential yourself, and they're going to reveal to you some of the information that they have about you. It's lifting the hood. It's kind of a big win for transparency advocates because now consumers are more informed, right? And so you log in and you see across all these categories, your home data, household vehicle data, economic data, your purchase history. Wow, that's a lot of stuff that they know about me. I feel better now, I guess, because I can make a choice about which data companies I'd like to engage with on the web. It seems progressive, but that's where the title comes into the talk, right? It's a trap. It's a trap. Now, I got to qualify, not all trans... I wanted to name this talk. This is kind of a non-traditional location for speaking. I wanted to name it Transparency is Bullshit. But it's not all actual bullshit, right? There are certain transparent practices, like when Reddit releases an accounting of how many times the government has queried it for national security agency data requests, et cetera. So transparency as a whole, we can't throw the baby out with the bathwater, but this... in this context of commercial monitoring, transparency is a trap. So what I want to do is explain why it's a trap, and it's a trap because consumer choice is an illusion. So let's quickly run through some of these reasons why transparency is a trap. And the first is that transparency is impossible, which seems like a pretty big barrier, but I'm going to warn you now, it gets worse before it gets better. So if you pay attention to the data broker industry and you actually look at how these companies work and how they operate, the structure of what they do precludes any kind of transparency because their business model is based on an asymmetry of privacy, which means that they know all the information about you, but you can't possibly know what information they have about you. It's not actually possible. And the reasons why it's not possible is that they don't actually collect most of the information. They buy it from other parties. There's no direct source that you can trace because they're siphoning up data from the post office. They're buying it from catalog manufacturers. They're getting data from all these types of reasons. Another reason why transparency is impossible is that some of the data doesn't even have an empirical source in the real world. It's algorithmically or computationally generated, right? So here's a data broker called YouGov. You can type, you go on their website and try this out yourself. Search for any brand personal thing. Okay, I typed in Nike, and it created this entire fictional profile based on algorithmic computational derived data, right? So there's really no way to trace some of this data because it's compiled from various sources. Some of it's generated by proprietary algorithms. And so if that's the case, it's not really possible to trace the origin of any given data point. So transparency is impossible in that regard. A second way that it's impossible, well, so some people say, okay, maybe we don't need to just give consumers all the information and let them know that the data, that let them know the details of the data that we have about them. Because obviously that's impossible because of all this technology, but what we need to do is just establish a context. So there's been a big move towards contextual transparency, which says that we should just establish a framework. So if you interact with a bank online, it should be similar to the privacy practices, it should be similar to the way you interact with a bank in real meat space. But the problem with contextual transparency is that the data broker industry is based on taking information that was collected for one purpose and repurposing it for something else downstream, right? So the point of it is to take data gaps in one market and fill that by using data that's been generated in a different transaction altogether. That's not some outlier of the business model, that is the core of the business model. So transparency is actually impossible in that regard. So let's assume we can figure out some way to give people the right information and make data brokers more transparent. Well, we also have a problem with human decision making, which is that social science has shown that we're actually really bad at making complex decisions when faced with really complex problems like privacy trade-offs. And we're exceptionally bad when we have to choose between an immediate benefit and some potential future harm that might happen in the future. We almost always will choose the immediate benefit, right? And we all know this because every time we're faced with the terms of service agreements, we just click agree to get the stuff that we want or the services that we want. And then the third reason, so let's say, let's just, you know, suspend disbelief and say somehow we can make commercial monitoring more transparent and we can solve the problems of human decision making. We still have a glaring lack of alternatives. If the ultimate end goal of transparency is to provide consumer choice, you can't make a choice if there's no choice to make. And what I mean by this is that surveillance has become the primary business model of the internet. There's no legitimate company that a majority average net user is going to turn to be able to protect themselves, right? We don't all have the luxury of being able to figure out Tor and you know, DuckDuckGo and all these kind of alternatives. So the model of consumer choice breaks down on all these various levels. So I'm running through very quickly, you know, why the model of consumer choice via transparency is flawed, but I said it was a trap. So why is it a trap? And this actually links really well with some of our previous presenters. And it's a trap because transparency has basically served as a tool of public relations. So I call this the public relations parry. A parry is when a blow is coming at you and you deflect it skillfully and then you get the upper hand. And that's exactly what sites like About the Data are. So they're public relations parries in a couple ways. One, they're consumer facing. So they make you, they give you like wonderful rationales about why they're collecting data about you to prevent advertisers from bombarding you with ads for bicycles if you are in fact a Ferrari aficionado. Thank God I feel so much better now. But we are not actually the main audience for these public relations parries. The main audience is the regulators themselves, the Federal Trade Commission. And we know this from the history of web development. So the reason why we have privacy policies, the reason why we have opt-out mechanisms, the reason why we have executive positions called chief privacy officers, all of those demonstrate this public relations parry in moments past, starting in the late 1990s with the Clinton administration. So this is a really great self-regulatory mechanism for industry, and it has worked really well. The FTC has been stepping it up a little bit as of late. However, this consumer empowerment transparency rationale still kind of rules the day. So transparency is also a trap in a more ideological and rhetorical way, and that is that it boils down to this idea of consumer empowerment, like I've been saying. But what good is consumer empowerment if you are the product? And this is really obvious, but it gets superseded and obfuscated by this transparency logic, right? So we're not the consumers of the data broker industry, we are the product. So what is the point of a consumer protection scheme, which is kind of under the FTC's mandate of making markets fair, if we're not the consumers, we're the inputs for all these, for a majority of these data collection practices. So this kind of ideological framework and the work that this rhetoric does of consumer empowerment, of market fairness, this explains why these regulators, who are incredibly brilliant and smart and hard-working researchers, can come up with a report in 2014 that says there's a fundamental lack of transparency within the data broker industry and still come back to the same kind of prescriptions for increased transparency. It's like a circle that keeps folding back on itself, and we're getting nowhere. So now comes the really hard part. Where do we go from here? It's much more fun and much easier to be a critic rather than kind of introduce possible solutions. So I'll just point to a few in the short time that I have left. And the point here is that we need multiple fronts. There's not gonna be one way to address this. And in a tech-savvy kind of individualistic mindset, a lot of the force of these arguments, and this is what Snowden himself are arguing, is that we need to take this into our own hands. No one's going to protect us but ourselves. And I agree with that. I think that's true. But we also need to move beyond the consumer frame at a public policy level. And one way to do that is to learn from history, right? So if we understand the PR parry and the transparency trap, we can start to move past this kind of individualistic market-based solutions. And so what you want to do is you want to possibly look at structural intervention. Lawyers don't like this. They call it paternalistic. But maybe we can have some benevolent paternalism a little bit to go with our individual technology-based solutions. So if we have banks that are too big to fail, maybe we have companies that are too big to surveil. So I have three quick recommendations. One is to enforce first-party engagement. No one can track you unless you go to their website specifically. That would solve a lot of these problems. Second is to ban reselling. Ban repurposing data that happens downstream. First-party engagement, ban reselling, and then limit data retention. The encryption debate is lines up with this very well, is that if companies are legally bound to delete the data after X amount of days and hours, and that's something we have to, you know, discuss, then the potential for this kind of surveillance and abuse is dramatically limited. Thank you.
everybody. My name's Joan, Boston Joan on Twitter. I follow back, so yep. Really happy to be here. I'm in from LA, where I'm a postdoc at the Institute for Society and Genetics, which has nothing to do with what I'm about to talk about. So I got interested in the notion of the Ferguson effect as a sociologist. I kept thinking, oh, this is interesting. You know, of course, social movements have really important impacts on the way public policy is formed, on the way that policing initiatives are formed, but the way that they evolve into the kinds of structures that we use to monitor police activity. And so one of the things that I was interested about the Ferguson effect was the rhetorical value of this term. And I'll show you exactly where it spins out from there. But there are three parts to the presentation. One is going to be about defining the Ferguson effect, who gets to say what it is. The second part is going to be a bit of a learning from history component, where we go back and actually look at what happened during the Rodney King assault and the kinds of recommendations, policy recommendations, and policing policy recommendations that were given to the Los Angeles Police Department. And you'll notice that they're very similar to what we're debating today, relationship to what happened after Ferguson. And then I'm going to talk about statistical activists, so stat activism, which is a concept that I became very familiar with working at UCLA with a few theorists who are really interested in the way that statistics have the capacity to guide behavior, and that when we're missing statistics, it's very difficult to get people or to get policies changed. So what is the Ferguson effect? It was a phrase coined by St. Louis Police Chief Sam Dodson, who used it to argue for increased cash for more patrol officers in November 2014. This is after Michael Brown was murdered in August of 2014. The theory that he was proposing in the media, that it was that crime is rising as criminals feel, quote, emboldened by the protests, while officers are apprehensive to conduct self-initiated activity due to fear of public reprisal or civil unrest. And self-initiated activity is a policing term which refers to hotspot policing, where police patrol neighborhoods and act on suspicious activity and intuition. So a self-initiated activity for a police officer, very common, is a stop and frisk. But they might also go up to businesses and shake the door handles to make sure that the doors are locked. But most of it has to do with stopping and asking questions. And in the media reports about the Ferguson effect, the St. Louis Police Department released this data. So they claim that self-initiated reports, self-initiated activity had decreased from 21,000 instances in March to only 7,000 in December. And Michael Brown was murdered on August 19th. Of course, what's missing is the data in between, right? And this is a very common problem that we face as sociologists, when we try to look at policing data, is we get these points in time, but we don't get trends over time. We get lots and lots of what Latour might call missing masses. And so I was struck by this, and then I thought about, well, what other kinds of data is missing? And of course, there's a big debate about the data that's missing, about the number of police killings nationally per year, and how that breaks down by gender and race and illness, if someone was armed or not armed. And so when I went back and looked at the Bureau of Justice statistics about that, you see a very similar kind of thing. There's lots and lots of missing data. The Bureau of Justice Statistics in 2003 and 2009 released reports that say, hey, we have 18,000 different policing departments, sheriff's departments, highway patrols. And even though they're federally mandated to submit data to the Attorney General quarterly, very few of them actually do. So there's really no way to know, even though it is a law that they do this, that no one's really reporting and no one's holding them accountable. And so I decided to look into, there are a few different scholars that decided to challenge Chief Dotson's claim, and they found that this theory is debunked. Crime was not increased, that there's certain types of crime increasing, but nationally crime is down, that there was some property crime increase in Missouri, but it was all within the normal ranges, but what was down were arrests. And Dotson later in other media accounts said that this might be due to fatigue, like the officers are tired from policing the protests, and that due to this fatigue, we might be seeing the decrease in arrests. So I wanted to ask a different kind of question, which is what is the aftermath of Ferguson? What are some things that we can actually point to that are actual effects? And so I started looking at the public calls for accountability and prevention, and the two most pronounced initiatives from the federal government have been body cameras, which the Obama administration released $75 million in federal funding. But the gasp moment is when you find out that that's just for the purchasing of cameras. None of that money can be used for storage. And so any of you that are server farmers are like, oh my God, where does the data go, right? And so you can buy all the body cameras that you want, but no one is in charge of the data. There's no teams in place to manage the data. There's no money in the budgets for that. And then the other thing was publicly accessible statistics on the number of people killed by police. And you can look up the President's Police Data Initiative, which is a call to increase transparency, of course, and to build community trust in the police. And I thought about it and I said, well, what is the other model, or what is the other counterexample to this, which was after the Rodney King assault, there was the mayor of Los Angeles called for a full-scale investigation of the use of excessive force in the LAPD. And they produced a 400-page document that stipulated that there are many, many problems with the LAPD, from leadership on down to the training of officers. And specifically, they did a bunch of interviews where they found that more than one quarter of the police force agreed that an officer's prejudice towards the suspect's race may lead to the use of excessive force, which is a really high percentage of officers to believe that that either themselves or one of their contemporaries may be racist. Two of the main recommendations for the Christer Commission were to hire data analysts to make databases and to make statistics about the police and about excessive force, and to make in-car cameras mandatory. And you know, you don't need to be a Foucauldian scholar to know that, you know, when someone's watching you, you're gonna behave differently. And when you know they're keeping statistics about you, or they're keeping statistics about you in relationship to the rest of your police force, that you are going to change your behavior, right? I mean, the same kind of technology is used in school, right? When you get a B, you know, uh-oh, I have to change my behavior. Like, I have to change the way I study. I have to change the way I do things. And unfortunately, in the follow-up report to the Christopher Commission, though, even though these were made recommendations, neither of them were taken up. The LAPD blamed, quote, bad software that recorded only raw numbers that had no qualitative description, and they were unable to perform adequate statistical analysis on reports of excessive force because the software wouldn't really allow them. And I find it hard to believe that that the software choice was the thing inhibiting them from doing what they needed to be doing. But what the Christopher Commission did find was that when you do the math and you do, you don't necessarily rely on the raw numbers as they are, but you put people in comparison to one another, that 10% of officers accounted for 27% of the claims of excessive force and complaints against police. So if you can find those 10% in the police force, you can reduce the number of complaints by over one quarter. That's huge, right? But of course, this is 1996, and it's a recommendation. It gets filed in the policy bin, and nobody really does anything about it. In terms of the video evidence, what we found is that when in-car cameras are used, the evidence is most likely to be used against the arrestee. The defendants take a plea deal, and it's only 5% of complaints are substantiated by video. So let me just roll through stat activism. What's important about this is that another initiative that's come out of Ferguson that doesn't rely us to think wholly about the body cameras is the use of crowdsourced database technologies and, you know, really good Google Docs to track police killings over time. And this is, I think, one of the most important innovations in social movements' use of technology currently happening. So there's the Guardians that counted, the Washington Post had an initiative, mappingpoliceviolence.org, fatalencounters.org, and killedbypolice.net. And I can show you, so all of these initiatives tracked police killings over 1 year, and you can see that they all get different numbers. And as a sociologist, you have to wonder why. So the Washington Post number is low because they only track shootings. But in terms of the other ones, I wanted to account for those differences, and I'll quickly go through them. And I need to thank my data visual analyst, Leslie Park, for making these. So the real change, or the real place in which we need to look in terms of accounting for differences among these citizen databases, is in the amount of different kinds of data that they will use. And you will see that The Guardian uses all kinds of different data to try to account for these, to account for police murders. But without actual good statistics from the police themselves, you know, you're stuck with crowdsourcing databases, using social media, original reporting, coroner's reports, public records, and Fatal Encounters uses freedom of information requests, which are really costly and time-consuming to try to track police violence and to track police killings. And so we can talk more about this in the Q&A. Thank you very much.
So thanks to our panelists. I wanted to open up it up for questions. So if there are any questions, I've been asked to make sure that people speak into the mic. So is there anyone has a question? Yes, please.
Thanks, guys. So this is for Karen and Solon. You mentioned at the end sort of that customer worker solidarity can be sort of a corrective for the type of refractive surveillance you're talking about. Do you have specific examples of what sort of form that takes or has taken?
I mean, so the intuition in general is that the more that customers would preserve their privacy, the less granular the management determinations that retailers can make would be, right? And that would operate to stop this displacement of risk onto workers. Basically, the more specific
employers can be about like precisely what their needs are and precisely how to deploy staff, like the worse that is for workers, like in lots of different ways, right? So the idea is that, you know, you actually have like, there's actually a protective effect of privacy, like that goes actually even beyond the consumer, right? In terms of like specifically, like has anybody taken this up? Not yet, because we haven't written the paper yet. But the hope, right, is that like that would be a way to understand privacy as a tool of economic justice in a way that I think it isn't currently conceptualized. Do you have anything else?
I'll just add very quickly that like the customer tracking using Wi-Fi in store is actually like a very unwelcome thing. It's like one of the more kind of extreme consumer tracking practices that people really don't like. And so that happens to be nice in the sense that like this is something that we're clearly, when consumers are at least knowledgeable about it, there's more likely going to be some kind of pressure to do something. And there are self-regulatory programs to deal with this that are pretty much totally ineffective. but yeah, we could talk more afterwards.
Thanks.
Yeah, please.
My question is first, like Sol and then Karen and Matt, to kind of just lump you together. I like the challenge to sort of like track the ecosystem of information flows and so forth. My question, why I'm asking all three of you, is how do you propose doing this? How do you keep track of such a dynamically evolving private sector that has so many innovating actors? Where there's not like government regulations that you can easily look up and track year by year. So just how did you pick the companies that you did? And why did you isolate those ones? I guess this is my second question.
Let me know if I'm not understanding your question properly, but in terms of, you know, methodology, like how do you choose who you study? You pick the biggest ones that are publicly traded, so you can read their 10-Ks and SEC documentation. That's a really useful way to understand how they're talking to their shareholders and how they're talking amongst themselves. In terms of the dynamic technology as a research and kind of policy challenge, that's definitely true 100%. I mean, this term data broker encompasses companies like Axiom that have been around for 40 years and used to, you know, sell JCPenney catalogs, and also companies that are brand new, venture capital funded. So there's a wide range of things going on, and this dynamic technology argument is actually one of the arguments that industry themselves use to stave off regulators when they want to come to the table and lay down some groundwork.
So I think maybe Solon has a different take on this. I think we could probably answer your question in two ways. So first, like in terms of like methodologically specifically what we've been doing. So probably the best thing that we did was we went to this like really big retail expo. Like there's this giant shit, and this is probably true I think of most tech sectors, and I think it's like totally fertile ground for social research. If you go to these expos where like companies gather to like display their wares and try and like get people to buy the tech that they're offering, like we went to this huge thing at the Javits Center that had like 540 companies. They were specifically like, they were all retail tech companies, right? So all they do is like try and get you to buy stuff by telling you like how much they can track about work, about customers in our case, and like how that integrated with worker management systems. So that was like super useful because like they all come to you. And then more generally, I would say like in terms of like studying this ecosystem approach, which we find very important, I think like this is sort of the job security pitch. Like this is why I think you really need really good and intensive funding for and opportunities for qualitative research into data collection practices. Like so much of the work about algorithms and like the effects of algorithms on social life is quantitative, right? Or like is done in a lab. And there's like obviously a huge place for that type of work because there are types of knowledge you can glean from that you can't in other ways. But the same is true for actually like walking around a retail store and watching what people do, right? Or like talking to a human about like the way that these practices unfold on the ground. So yeah, it's just a little push, I guess, for more qualitative work in that vein.
Uh,
Hi. Thanks for a bunch of really fascinating talks. I thought it was really interesting, and this is not a comment, more than a question. It is a question. I thought it was really interesting how, like, all the talks were obviously about surveillance, but there was kind of surveillance, and then I guess on the other side, counter surveillance, which was, you know, so it's kind of like within and against surveillance. So I guess what I'm going to ask to the panel is, do you think there's a possibility that the kind of surveillance of the state and the police and authorities could be done by working out how these companies, like the algorithms they have, the kind of like high technologies that they have, and learning how to use them and kind of turning them to the common good, I guess, or something like that? Do you think that there's any possibility of these things, or developing parallel platforms that are easy to use, but at the same time are as powerful as this stuff that keeps our credit card data and whatever?
I'm going to just interject and say it's a great question. I would have asked it myself. That's not why it's great, but. Anyone? Oh, yeah, Joe.
I guess, you know, in terms of creating counter power, these kinds of initiatives to track and map and create statistics about the state, I think are really important ways in which people can get together. There were instances last month where people were getting together and trying to count votes related to, I think, the Hawaii election. There was a sort of all-night Google Doc-a-thon where people were going and trying to create their own statistics and monitor these things. And I think that being able to share information online, I mean, the research on social media, you know, and how people use Twitter and Facebook is it's, you know, it's sexy and it's hot, but when you actually get down into the depths and details and you start to look at how are people getting together and creating, like, power, they're doing it by creating the same kinds of power that the state uses to control us, or the credit card rating agencies. Like, could you imagine, out of this kind of data, a rating agency in which we know which police departments are really violent, right? And then having, you know, a way to hold them accountable publicly. And we can see that these kinds of data projects trickle up, right? It's not that the state was saying, oh, we need to release the data on police killings. You have five different citizen initiatives saying, you need to release the data on police killings, and then the Obama administration acquiesces.
I think I have just a really brief answer to that. I think that those types of resistance strategies are the most useful when they're used in conjunction with other methods and forms of resistance. I think, unfortunately, a lot of times, like building alternative platforms or collecting data turns into an end in and of itself, and in that case, then it sort of becomes separated from the broader sort of institutional critique that I think makes those types of technologies really potent. So I think making sure that that's included in broader, maybe, struggles against police as an institution is where that the power of those strategies comes in.
I mean, I'll just maybe add to what Karen said a moment ago, which is that maybe people already know that one of the main controversies around scheduling software really was something that came out of a New York Times Magazine article, I believe, which was just following one particular person, actually. So it was tracking the experience of one particular woman whose life was, like, highly disrupted by the use of these technologies. And I'll just add that, in a way, this hasn't really been the direction of the debate, but it's not entirely obvious why these same tools, which are trying to predict demand, couldn't be used to bring greater stability to work. They're actually seem to have had the opposite effect, like increasing instability. And in a way, the data that is being produced to manage workers can be potentially a tool of accountability to say, like, look, you have the capacity potentially to do this differently and to serve a different end. So I think there's, like, a role here both for these kind of personal narratives and qualitative research that Karen's describing, but also maybe trying to explain how these tools can be, like, within themselves have a accountability mechanism that hasn't been explored as effectively as it could.
This is amazingly awkward. So my question is for Matthew. Sort of at the beginning of your presentation, you sort of like side noted, oh, there's like the good kind of transparency, which is like transparency reports for like law enforcement requests, which is kind of what I was assuming you were talking about. Mm-hmm. And it was hard for me throughout your presentation not to apply all of the critiques that you applied to the sort of consumer side to the law enforcement request side. And so I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about how you see those as like normatively different, or like whether, you know, it has to do with democracy, like how you differentiate between those, because it seems like that's kind of the law enforcement request is kind of a theme running through Julianne Jones' presentation.
Thanks. I'd say that really that kind of remark was just to differentiate and delimit the scope of my talk. I don't want to talk too authoritatively about, you know, NSA requests, et cetera, because, again, transparency exists in, it's this multifaceted sort of a light-handed approach to regulating behavior and social contracts. And I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater for transparency, so I don't think that's a very satisfying answer, but I'll say, you know, I'm trying to delimit it to this arena of consumer monitoring very particularly.
Hi, so my question is for Matt and Joan, which is that both of you seem to be looking at these data sets where people have a very vested interest in not revealing them. I was wondering if you had experienced or looked at any times in which there were actually releases of these in the police instance, maybe Cincinnati, where there was a lawsuit that was filed and they had to release all the dashboard cams and other kinds of things that sort of reveal these tensions between what they really have and where that data goes and, you know, all the things that we aren't mapping in terms of, you know, the types of data that we ultimately need. And the same for Matt, where, you know, if there's any instances where there's sort of a revealing of the backstage that happens either through legal or other sort of hacks or means that we can sort of get a full sense of the unseeability of the data that we're talking about.
Sure, I'll just say briefly that that's been a real challenge because even though some of these companies are publicly traded, et cetera, peeling back the curtain is difficult because there's a discourse of trade secrecy that permeates all the way to Washington. So when this data brokers kind of reached a fever pitch, the Senate held hearings, the FTC held workshops and hearings, and the CEOs of these companies would you know, tell the chairman of the Senate Commerce Committee, we can't reveal the names of our clients, we can't reveal the names of our sources, that's the secret sauce, that's the black box that we can't possibly reveal. So it's definitely a challenge, and honestly the way I've been able to look at a lot of this data is through a leak. One of the product catalogs for Axiom was leaked on the web on 2013. I cannot find it again. I have it, and I don't really know how I got it, right? And someone leaked it, and it's for clients' eyes only, right? And so that gives you a window into what exactly those. And also, there are legal sort of means if a lawsuit happens, some kind of stuff comes out that way as well.
So one of the most interesting things I think I couldn't really talk about in my presentation is the development of actual statistical software used by police called CompStat, which was a platform designed in conjunction with the NYPD and Giuliani and Bratton to track literally everything they could about crime and officers' interaction with the community, down to very fine-grained analysis of how many minutes does an officer spend outside the car versus inside the car. In a foot pursuit, how long does the foot pursuit take? And they keep these really fine-grained, detailed records of everything that happens on every shift. And this started about 1995 and continues and has only expanded. So the idea that the data's missing is obviously a misnomer, but that the data is not being federated and aggregated correctly in a way that it would be shocking if we were to get these statistics, because we would have to change policing policies as a result of knowing what's going on. But one of the things that I've been looking at UCLA anyway and watching is the use of predictive policing models that are using these old databases of CompStat databases to decide and figure out at which points different blocks in Los Angeles are going to become hotspots that week, and they actually publish on Twitter. There's like a predictive policing tweet that'll go out every morning saying, hey, at Venice and Overland, there could be heightened potentiality for crime. And so they'll assign more officers, they'll do more flybys of the helicopter, and they'll try to be more present in those spaces. And so I think in terms of looking at the unseeable data, we know that it's there, and it's starting to leak out in these really strange ways that are alliances between industry and the university. And so that's where I'm going next.
Okay, I actually have one for Karina, and other people may want to answer this or address it. But one of the things that occurred to me is, and I don't like to use this word, but there seems to be a clash between sort of the neoliberal logic, right, that encryption is necessary in a consumer sense, right, and what you call the carceral logic, right? And those don't seem to fit together very well. So I was wondering if you could speak to that a little bit.
Yeah, so one of the codes that actually I mentioned earlier that I didn't have time to talk about was this idea that I think that the actual earlier debates were about getting those two things to line up. And what it came out in was this idea that having a very strong U.S.-led industry that's producing encryption projects is good for national security, because if everybody is using Apple, if everybody's using iPhones, then the industry is willing to work with the NSA and willing to work with the FBI, but you're not going to get a Japanese company to work with the FBI or a Chinese company or even a German company to work with the police. So what you need to do is deregulate and really go with this laissez-faire, so neoliberal model for governing encryption markets, so that we can help you achieve your law enforcement goals. And that is actually one of the core sort of issues that came up in the earlier debates. I think we all remember it as being a privacy debate, but that was actually a big component of the contention between industry and the government, was about lining up those two logics, which we could argue they are lining up right now, it's actually a pretty scary, scary thing.
Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to be selfish here. I actually have another one. For Sola and Karen, I think one of the a key element I took from the talk is the ways that consumers are sort of being enlisted in that in surveillance of workers. But to me, part of the problem or what is how do you resolve the issue that consumers a lot of times they're not aware that they are being enlisted in these ways, right? I think Matt even spoke to this a little bit about the inability for the everyday person to invest in the obfuscation techniques and things like that necessary to not be tracked. So how can you speak to that? Was that clear?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'll say one thing, and this might actually, I'd be interested to hear what other people think of this. So people might know that Apple in particular started to randomize MAC addresses. I don't know if anyone. So basically the way that you're able to track people using their phone is that each phone has a unique identifier called the MAC address. That's generally how they're able to track people over time. So they can see that this is the same customer that was in a store last week. And Apple kind of probably because of its part of its general approach to trying to make privacy part of its pitch, introduced randomization. And so actually talking to people who sell these products, like they're extremely aware of this, and they're like, oh yeah, but in most markets, Android is like most of like the customers you're dealing with. So like there's no actual like response from the people who are selling these things. But there is also some technical work that's shown that like the randomization isn't as effective as possible. The effect of that basically is that like it's hard to track people over time, right? And that was not because like individuals themselves have chosen to do something, but like you know the manufacturer had done something for a variety of potential reasons. But it is interesting to see how that's like been addressed by the vendors themselves.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you, panel. Thank you very much. This is very enlightening. Thanks, everyone else. I appreciate it. And of course, you're free to come up and chat with people if they want to chat with you.
Thank you. That's awesome.
Really. I'm totally thrilled to meet you.
Hey, you too.
And, yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, but your question is spot on. It's sort of like, even if there is this relationship, maybe it doesn't amount to very much because,
I guess we're going
to be talking about these, conferences past type of things.
Yeah. Well, I thought, one of the things I thought was the right way.
No, I'm serious. This is like a they're in room A.
I was at the